Welcome to the 28th lecture in the course Engineering Electromagnetics. For the last few lectures, we have been discussing the parallel plane guide. This guide consisted of conducting planes which were infinite in dimensions. Now, obviously, such a waveguide cannot be realized in practice. A more realizable shape of guide is what is called a rectangular waveguide, and that is what we start with today. And we shall go on to consider the transverse magnetic modes in such a waveguide. First, let me show you what is it that we have in mind when we say a rectangular waveguide. The rectangular waveguide can be represented by the following schematic figure. It consists of perfectly conducting metal walls at x equal to 0 and x equal to a, and also at y equal to 0 and y equal to b. And the region inside this enclosure is completely hollow. It can be evacuated, it can be filled with some inert gas, or it may be just simple air. Such a waveguide is called a rectangular waveguide. Of course, it will continue depending on the length of the waveguide required for some distance along the z direction. The rectangular waveguide belongs to the general class of cylindrical waveguides, where the cross section could be circular or rectangular. Okay. So, instead of saying a rectangular cross section cylindrical waveguide, for brief we simply say rectangular waveguide. Similarly, a circular waveguide would be one which has a circular cross section. Apart from these straightforward cross sections, one could have any cross section in general and it could work as a waveguide. However, these other cross sections offer really no advantage. They are not easier to manufacture and they are certainly more difficult to analyze. And therefore, rectangular waveguides or circular waveguides are by far the most popular types of waveguides. Having introduced what a rectangular waveguide looks like, we should also try to explain the significance of going to such a form. Compared to parallel plane waveguide, we have already said that that structure is not practically realizable. The cylindrical waveguide or the rectangular waveguide in particular is more realizable. But otherwise, considering the various types of transmission lines and the other guides that we have considered so far, what is the place of the cylindrical waveguides that we will like to clarify? We have considered different types of transmission lines and guides, and the general purpose for these structures was mentioned in the beginning of the course, to transport the electromagnetic signal or energy efficiently and without any distortion. These are the requirements for a good transmission structure. Now, let us evaluate the various structures we have considered so far from these points of view. Some of these structures, for example, the parallel wire transmission line and also the parallel plane guide, are likely to radiate if they are operated at very high frequencies, since they are open. Radiation is going to be considered in more detail later on, but just the fact that they are open can result in radiation if the frequency of operation is raised sufficiently high. Also, they are subject to interference, because interfering signals can enter the transmission structure. All right. So, therefore, there are types of structures which are open in nature, and they will cause problems sooner or later. One could argue that all right, we consider the coaxial transmission line, which is completely enclosed and therefore is not likely to radiate. However, the coaxial transmission line, as also some other types of transmission lines, require dielectric material for support, right? And therefore, in addition to conductor loss, dielectric loss is always present. Although we now have available dielectric materials which have very low loss, up to fairly high microwave frequencies like 30-40 gigahertz, still dielectric loss is going to be present, and therefore they are going to be lossy compared to this kind of waveguides. Okay? And therefore, the advantages of this kind of cylindrical waveguides can be put down. They will not radiate, and therefore, they are not subject to radiation or interference. And also, as we have just tried to explain, they have very low attenuation. The waveguide will be fabricated out of very good conducting material, and it can even be silver plated to reduce the attenuation further, and also there is no requirement for using a dielectric material. So, dielectric loss is altogether eliminated. There is another advantage to using this kind of waveguides, and that becomes clear when we consider the power handling capability. The materials that use some sort of dielectric will have limited power handling capability because of the dielectric breakdown. If the electric field increases beyond a certain value, the dielectric material will undergo breakdown and the guide will not be able to propagate power levels higher than that particular value. The waveguide, since it uses no dielectric material, can transport much higher power levels. Waveguides can handle megawatts of power level if they are appropriately designed, and therefore, apart from freedom from radiation or interference and very low attenuation, they can handle very high power levels. And while we have other relatively newer transmission structures evolved, for example, strip lines and microstrip lines, which we are not discussing in this course, but will be discussed in a subsequent course. When we go to very high microwave frequencies, millimeter wave frequencies, for example, 100 gigahertz, those alternative newer structures do not offer performance which is comparable to these waveguides. They suffer from higher loss and radiation, and therefore, at very high frequencies, let us say millimeter wave frequencies, one will still use this kind of cylindrical or rectangular waveguides. Okay? And that clearly brings out the areas where this kind of waveguides are going to be utilized. Wherever the application requires very low attenuation or high power handling capability, or we need to use it at very high frequencies like hundreds of gigahertz, we would utilize this structure. Okay? And therefore, these waveguides have their own very special place in this area. The objective for us today and the subsequent few lectures is to understand the type of waves that the rectangular waveguide can support, and what are the associated modes in these waves, and what are the characteristics of these modes, that is the propagation characteristics and the field configuration, etcetera. The method that we are going to follow will be very similar to the method that we followed for the parallel plane waveguide. That is, we shall write down the Maxwell's equations for the region inside the waveguide, which will be assumed to be a perfect dielectric, at least to begin with. And then these Maxwell's equations will be solved subject to the boundary conditions imposed by this perfectly conducting enclosure constituted by the waveguide. All right, and therefore, from that point of view, the concept should be quite familiar. We write down the Maxwell's equations for the region inside the waveguide, del cross H equal to j omega epsilon E, and del cross E equal to minus j omega mu H. The way these equations are written, a few things are apparent. We are assuming that the medium filling the waveguide is isotropic, homogeneous, time invariant, etcetera, and also we are assuming that the fields are having a time variation which is sinusoidal, and we have written these equations using phasor notation, so that each del by del t factor is replaced by the factor j omega. The wave equation satisfied by the magnetic field intensity vector and the electric field intensity vector is also written here, del squared H equal to minus omega squared mu epsilon H, okay, which can be substituted in terms of further symbols, and a similar equation is satisfied by the electric field intensity vector. Next, we need to expand these vector equations into their corresponding components in a suitable coordinate system. A suitable coordinate system will be one where the boundary conditions applicable to the structure at hand can be applied in a simple manner. Since the boundaries are described very easily in terms of x equal to constant or y equal to constant kind of functions, therefore, the Cartesian coordinate system will be the best one to expand these Maxwell's equations, and that is what is done in the following equations. These are the three component equations corresponding to this Maxwell's equation, and these are the corresponding three component scalar equations for this Maxwell's equation. Also, the wave equation can be written out in terms of the x, y and z derivatives for the magnetic field, and a similar equation will hold good for the electric field. For example, we will have del 2E by del x squared plus del 2E by del y squared plus del 2E by del z squared equal to minus omega squared mu epsilon E. All right. So, these are proceeding in a very general manner. The various equations. The next step, as you would recall from your experience with the parallel plane guide, was to try and put down the nature of these variations with respect to x, y and z to the extent possible. And there we can easily identify at least the nature of the z variation. If we assume that the wave is propagating in the z direction, then the variation in the z direction can be written as e to the power minus gamma bar z, where gamma bar becomes the propagation constant, and in general it is alpha plus j beta, that is, it may have a real part and an imaginary part. So that as far as del by del z is concerned, the partial derivative with respect to the z direction, that can be replaced by minus gamma bar. We are not in a position to put down the variations with respect to x or y directions for the moment. Those will emerge from the boundary conditions, but the z derivative in these various equations can be replaced by minus gamma bar, and that is what we undertake next. Taking up this equation, we will have del h z by del y plus gamma bar h y equal to j omega epsilon E x, then minus gamma bar h x minus del h z by del x will be equal to j omega epsilon E y, and the last component equation will be del h y by del x minus del h x by del y equal to j omega epsilon E z. Since there is no z derivative in this equation, it remains as it was. In a similar manner, we write down the three component equations corresponding to the second Maxwell's equation, and completing this gives us the following equations. Del E z by del y plus gamma bar E y. As you can notice, we can get this set by simply interchanging E and H and epsilon and minus mu. So that is what we are doing. This is equal to minus j omega mu and H x. So just by inspection, the other set can be written. The second equation is minus gamma bar E x minus del E z by del x, which should be equal to minus j omega mu h y, and finally del E y by del x minus del E x by del y should be equal to minus j omega mu and h z. All right, the wave equations for the h and e further give us del 2 h z, and we write these for the z components. Del 2 h z by del x squared plus del 2 h z by del y squared, and then the third term becomes plus gamma bar squared h z, which should be equal to minus omega squared mu epsilon h z. In a similar manner, the z component for the wave equation satisfied by the electric field will come out to be del 2 E z by del x squared plus del 2 E z by del y squared plus gamma bar squared E z, which should be minus omega squared mu epsilon E z. That is as far as one can proceed by identifying the nature of the z variation. The next step would be to use these equations in an appropriate manner and obtain expressions for the transverse field components in terms of the longitudinal field components. The longitudinal field components are the ones which are in the z direction, and the ones transverse to this direction, x or y components, are the transverse field components, and those we can express in terms of the longitudinal field components. So, since the longitudinal field components are going to play a somewhat special role, we have written the wave equations only for those field components. So, next we attempt to write transverse field components in terms of longitudinal field components. Okay. For example, one could pick up this first equation in this slot, which involves E x and H y, and of course, H z, del H z by del y. And similarly, locate another equation which involves same two transverse field components, which happens to be the one here. It involves E x and H y with other multiplying factors, and then del E z by del x. So, if we combine these two equations, we should be able to get E x and H y in terms of derivatives of E z and H z. For example, the steps will be as follows. From here, from this equation, we will get H y equal to 1 by j omega mu, and then gamma bar E x plus del E z by del x, which expression for H y can be substituted here, so that we get j omega epsilon E x equal to del H z by del y plus gamma bar by j omega mu into gamma bar E x plus del E z by del x. Okay. So, we have got now two terms containing E x which can be combined, and then E x can be expressed in terms of del H z by del y and del E z by del x. Upon simplification, this gives us the following result. We have E x equal to minus j omega mu by H squared del H z by del y minus gamma bar by h squared del E z by del x, where h squared is a new symbol. Substitute it for gamma bar squared plus omega squared mu epsilon. Okay. So, this is one illustration of how we can get the various transverse field components in terms of the longitudinal field components. By continuing with the same two equations in that pair, this one and this one, we will be able to get the expression for h y in terms of the longitudinal field components, and then by picking up these two equations we will be able to get the remaining transverse field components. All right. So, having explained the procedure, I think now we can put down the final expressions, which read as follows: E y equal to j omega mu by h squared del h z by del x minus gamma bar h squared del E z by del y. And similarly, the magnetic field components, h x comes out to be minus gamma bar by h squared del h z by del x plus j omega epsilon by h squared del E z by del y, and finally h y comes out to be minus gamma bar by h squared del h z by del y minus j omega epsilon by h squared and del E z by del x, which completes the expressions for the transverse field components in terms of longitudinal field components. What is the significance of this manner of expressing the transverse field components in terms of the longitudinal field components? Now, we can say that one can break up the general solution into two parts. One part would be where, let us say, E z is 0, but h z is not equal to 0, okay. And the other part would be h z equal to 0 and E z not equal to 0, okay. And of course, we said in case both longitudinal field components are non-zero, if they exist in a problem, we can superpose the particular solutions of these two kinds and obtain the final general solution. As you would recall, this solution leads to TE type of solution, transverse electric waves, because there is no longitudinal electric field component in such solution, and this solution leads to transverse magnetic type of waves, TM type of solutions. And if both E z and h z become 0, then the entire framework crumbles down. There are no fields which exist in that case. Okay. One can see that from the basic Maxwell's equations as well. And therefore, we say that for the cylindrical waveguides in general and for the rectangular waveguide in particular, there is no TEM type of solution which is possible. A transverse electric and magnetic wave does not exist for the cylindrical waveguides. Okay. Now, it is fine that it is coming out mathematically from this. Is it possible to see in some other simple manner that for cylindrical waveguides, the TEM solution is ruled out? It cannot exist. Now, fortunately, such an argument can be made if we consider the rectangular waveguide like this and make an assumption for a moment that it is a TEM type of wave which is existing on the structure inside the rectangular waveguide. All right. So, let us assume a TEM type of wave inside the rectangular waveguide, meaning there is no Ez and there is no Hz, then it would be a transverse electric and magnetic field, right? Which means any field components that do exist transverse to the direction of propagation to the z direction. Fine. Let us focus attention on the magnetic field. It is completely transverse to the direction of propagation, it exists in the xy plane. Now, the magnetic field lines must exist as closed lines, closed loop lines, because there are no free magnetic poles. All right. And therefore, if we start from the first Maxwell's equation, that is say del cross H equal to j omega epsilon E for the sinusoidally time varying fields and for the situation that there is no source within the waveguide. And if we take the surface integral over the cross section of the waveguide for this, then using Stokes' theorem, it will change to H dot dl equal to j omega epsilon E dot dA. All right. And we may consider the z directed component of both sides. In this case, with this particular assumption, the entire result on both sides should be z directed only. So, if we consider the z directed component, then it should be j omega epsilon E z d a, right? That is the line integral of the magnetic field in the xy plane should be related to some z directed electric field in this manner. However, by virtue of our assumption that it is a TEM wave which is propagating, there is no Ez everywhere and therefore, this is equal to 0, which means this line integral is 0, which means that there is no magnetic field which is existing. If it did, it must have some non-zero line integral value. For example, in a coaxial cable, the magnetic field lines are concentric with the axis of the coaxial cable and H dot dl is equal to the current flowing in the inner conductor, right. Similar thing should be possible here. It is required if there are closed loop magnetic field lines to exist in the xy plane. However, there is no conductor here, inner conductor here to support a conduction current. The electric field we are assuming to be 0 and therefore, the magnetic field must also be 0 everywhere. And therefore, such an assumption is not consistent with a propagating wave and we say that a TEM wave cannot exist in a rectangular waveguide or in a cylindrical waveguide. The argument is quite general, can be extended to all cylindrical waveguides. And therefore, we say that no TEM wave on, we can generalize this on cylindrical waveguides. Okay. So, therefore, we have to talk of either a TE mode or a TM mode on the rectangular waveguide. We can pick up any one, let us pick up the transverse magnetic type of solution, which says that HZ should be 0 and EZ should be non-zero. So, we try to work out a solution for the TM type of wave, for which, as identified here, HZ is 0, but EZ is non-zero. Now, we have to pick up a suitable equation from this large number, okay, where we can make out the behavior of the z component of the electric field, and that is the z component of the wave equation for the electric field. EZ is also a field component which is tangential to the perfectly conducting magnetic walls, and therefore boundary conditions can be applied on this component in a straightforward manner. So, from these considerations, we consider the equation to be satisfied by the Z component of the electric field, and that is del 2 EZ by del x squared plus del 2 EZ by del y squared plus gamma bar squared EZ, which should be equal to minus omega squared mu epsilon EZ. We essentially have reached a stage where the solution for the rectangular waveguide boils down to solving this equation subject to the boundary conditions. Okay. Now, here we try to make out what is the nature of EZ. EZ in general is to be a function of the three coordinates x, y and z. However, the z variation has been identified to be corresponding to that of a propagating wave along the z direction, and therefore, we can write this as EZ naught, that is some sort of an amplitude factor which is a function of x and y, times e to the power minus gamma bar z, which can be substituted in this parent equation, and a similar equation is going to hold good for this amplitude factor. Okay. Then we use a method which is very frequently used in such situations, and that is the method of separation of variables. Or the method of variable separation. What does this method consist of? It amounts to making a very important assumption. The assumption is as follows. We say that let EZ naught, which is now a function of x and y alone, be expressible as a product of two functions. One we call x and the other we call y, where x is a function of x alone and y is a function of y alone. The simplification that this causes will be seen as we proceed. However, this kind of a procedure, that is assuming that a term which is a function of two coordinates can be expressed as a product of two functions and each function depending on only one direction at a time, has been put on a fairly rigorous mathematical footing. And wave equations have been shown to be variable separable in I think 11 coordinate systems, including of course the rectangular coordinate system. Okay. Therefore, one should take take it that this step is a rigorous mathematically proven step. However, for us it is very important because it simplifies the considerations very much. So, these expressions with this assumption, these are substituted back in the parent equation, and when we do that we get y times d2x by dx squared e to the power minus gamma bar z plus x times d2y by dy squared e to the power minus gamma bar z plus gamma bar squared xy e to the power minus gamma bar z, which should be equal to minus omega squared mu epsilon and x y e to the power minus gamma bar z. We have just made the substitution for E z in the parent equation. Now, since e to the power minus gamma bar z is a factor which is common to all terms, it can be dropped and we do not expect it to be 0 in any case, and we can combine the omega squared mu epsilon and the gamma bar squared terms into h squared. Therefore, what we are left with is a fairly simple expression which reads as 1 by x. Okay. There is another step that we are squeezing in between. We are dividing through by E z naught, that is the product x y is being used to divide through these equations, and once that is done we get 1 by x d 2 x by d x squared plus 1 by y d 2 y by d y squared plus h squared, which should be equal to 0. Okay, one could say that we have divided through by E z, right, and for a non-trivial solution E z should be non-zero. Now, we can write this in a slightly different form and then one can use a very interesting argument. We write this as 1 by x d 2 x by d x squared plus h squared, which should be equal to minus 1 by y d 2 y by d y squared, and recall here that h squared is gamma bar squared plus omega squared mu epsilon. What is the nature of h squared? Given a certain waveguide with certain parameters of the medium filling the waveguide and an operating frequency, the wave will propagate with a certain propagation constant, and therefore h squared is essentially a constant. Let us say at a given, for a given structure and for a given frequency, fine. And therefore, if you look at the left hand side, what is the left hand side? It is essentially a function of x alone. It involves terms which are only a function of the x direction, x variable, d2x by dx squared and 1 by x. And by virtue of our assumption that x is a function of x alone, entire left hand side is a function of the variable x only. Right? By the same argument, the right hand side is a function of y variable alone. Which equality should hold good over the domain over which we are seeking the solution, that is the interior of the waveguide, that is for different values of x and y, x ranging from 0 to a, y ranging from 0 to b. This equality should be maintained between two functions, one of which is a function of x alone and the other is a function of y alone. This is possible only if either side is a constant. Both left hand side and right hand side must be a constant, they should not remain a function of x or y. Then only for varying values of x and y the equality will be maintained. Okay? And therefore, we say that both must be equal to a constant, that is they should not remain a function of either x or y. All right? And therefore, we are now in a position to say that let 1 by x d2x by dx squared plus h squared be equal to another constant, say a squared. Okay? By virtue of the arguments we have just gone through. Similarly, the other side 1 by y d2y by dy squared should be equal to minus a squared. Okay. What have we achieved? We were dealing with partial differential equation, second order partial differential equation, and now we have to deal with only second order ordinary differential equations, and they have come out in a form where the solution can be written by inspection, very familiar form of the second order differential equation. Okay. So, that is the purpose of using the method of variable separation. We continue this process further. And here it is quite straightforward. We can write y equal to, let us say, some amplitude, some constant of integration c 3 cosine of a y plus c 4 sine of a y. The other side needs some more manipulations. We rewrite this as 1 by x d2x by dx squared equal to a squared minus h squared, and since we prefer to have solution in terms of sine and cosine functions, and that is the kind of boundary conditions, multiple zeros are expected in the solution, and therefore, we again rewrite this as minus b squared, okay, where quite obviously h squared is equal to a squared plus b squared, which relation we shall draw upon a little later. and therefore, we now have x also equal to some constant of integration C 1 times cosine B x plus C 2 sine of B x. All right, and since we had Ez not equal to x times y, and entire Ez required another factor e to the power minus gamma bar z, we can now constitute the entire z component of the electric field, all variations x, y, z now coming in place, so that we can have E z equal to C 1 cosine of B x plus C 2 sine of B x multiplied by C 3 cosine of A y plus C 4 sine of A y times, of course, e to the power minus gamma bar z. All right. What remains to be evaluated are these constants of integration and, if possible, A and B. Fine. How will these be done? These will be done by ensuring that the boundary condition is satisfied by the z component of the electric field. As we saw earlier, the z component of the electric field is a component which is tangential to the walls, which are assumed perfectly conducting, and therefore, at the walls x equal to 0, x equal to a, and at y equal to 0, y equal to b, it must drop to 0. So, enforcing that kind of condition tells us that for Ez to be 0 at x equal to 0 would require that C 1 is 0, and for it to be 0 at y equal to 0 would require that C 3 is 0. Further, for it to be 0 at x equal to a would require that b a is equal to, let us say, m pi, an integral multiple of pi, where m can take on values 1, 2, 3, etcetera. It can be seen that m equal to 0 would lead to all field components going to 0. And similarly, at y equal to b, for Ez to be 0, we must have a times b equal to, say, n pi, where n is another integer, etcetera. So that we see that b is m pi by a, and a is n pi by b. So you we find that these constants capital A and capital B are now coming out in terms of the waveguide dimensions small a and small b, and of course the indices m and n, which, as you can make out now, will constitute the various orders of variation along the x and the y direction. Okay. And therefore, we are now in a position to complete the expression for Ez. It turns out to be Ez equal to, we can combine the constants C 2 and C 4 into a new constant, say capital C, and then we have sin m pi by a x sin n pi by b y, and of course e to the power minus gamma bar z. which satisfies the Maxwell's equations and the boundary conditions for the TM type of waves. This is one field component for the TM MN modes belonging to the TM type of waves. The other field components can be obtained by going back to the expression for the transverse field components in terms of the longitudinal field components. This is where we stop today. We have introduced the rectangular waveguides and we have seen how we can work out a solution for propagating waves in the rectangular waveguide, and in particular we are on our way to obtain the field components for the transverse magnetic type of waves. Thank you.